thank you for this invitation. And for me, it's an honor that the students invite me. That is a good interpellation, better than when the academy invite me. I was 3 weeks ago in Berlin, and two, a contact with the Mexican. They organized a meeting with the students, German students, of the doctor and master level, and there were more than 90 students that would like listen some questions. And I would like immediately speak on the question, but you see too that my English is very bad. It's not English, it's Spanglish. I studied in France, in Germany, I was in Israel, I speak other languages, but I didn't study in the Anglo-Saxon world, and I don't speak English very well, but I try to speak in this new koine, new universal possible means of communication. And I could like speak on one subject after a experience of yesterday. Yesterday I discussed with a very important Norwegian philosopher, very important, but because he studied with Marcuse, was in the line of the Frankfurt School, I thought that were very easy, the dialogue. But when we began to speak, I discovered something new, and I couldn't do a dialogue like I thought, because he was in another position. We studied with almost the same philosophers, but the positions was from Norway. That means peripheral from Central Europe. And Latin American is peripherals of the same Europe. And I thought that was easy, the dialogue. No, was very difficult. Why? Because there are some peripheral countries in Europe. I must meditate the word that I use. No, I did in English. It's a question of the professor Žižek that come from Slovenia. It's peripheral of the Central Europe, but it's more European than the Central Europe. And the question, I think, is not only for you and for us too, and for me, because it's a biographical struggle against myself. It's a question of the Eurocentrism. And I would like to speak on these questions now. Because that, not only Latin America, and the academy, I could say a number, hypothetical, 90% of the professors of history, philosophy, and many other disciplines in Latin America are Eurocentric. It's our problem. I was educated in a so strict Eurocentrical vision that I studied 10 semester philosophy, I studied Greek and Latin, my age, in the 40-50 of the last century. I am very old. But my idea was go to Paris, to Athens, and know Germany. And I finished my bachelor, 10 semester in philosophy, and 2 weeks after my examinations, when I'm a stipend, I took a ship, and I crossed the Atlantic the first time, and I crossed 4 times the Atlantic in ship. After 100 times in airplanes, but in ships too. And my idea was go to Europe. because I studied Platon, Aristotle in Greek, and Ciceron and Thomas of Aquinas in Latin, and Descartes in French, and Kant, Hegel, Marx in German, etc. But you cannot understand that I took a ship in Buenos Aires, the capital of the South. And in the next day, I was in Montevideo, in the other side of the river of La Plata, Le Plate. And I arrived to Montevideo, and I said, what is Montevideo? Nobody spoke in my life on Montevideo. And I thought in Paris and Athens. I couldn't say almost nothing on Uruguay. That was a country close to my country. The other day I arrived in Santos, in Brazil, black people, African culture, el cafecino. And I studied on any philosopher of Brazil. You see, you have this book. The Caribbean, Latino, and Latin American Philosophical Thought. 13,000 until 2000. 700 of philosophy in Latin America. 700, not only 500. 2 columns. 1,100 pages. More than 100 pages of bibliography on the Latin American philosophy. Randall Collins, a professor in Chicago, has a book more or less like this, but with 200 pages less and with more, with not too much content on Chinese philosophy, Indostani philosophy, Islamic philosophy, Bantu, European, North American. And there is not one line on the philosophy of Latin America. Because when I finished this book, that is not mine, there is more than 100 authors, as I sent to Chicago to Professor Randall Collins and said, that is for a chapter that you didn't write in your whole history of philosophy. Doesn't exist Latin America for many Latin Americans. And especially for the philosophers, that are the column, central column of the Eurocentric vision. And to prove that, I will speak on the horizon of all epistemological horizons, the history. I put this asked question in hundreds of universities. In Peking, in Delhi, in Nairobi, and more than 30 universities in Germany, in France, more than 30 universities of the United States, in all Latin America. And I ask this question also to you. We studied the world history when this periodization, antiquity, Middle Age, modernity. I studied the world history with this periodization in my high school in Argentina and the university. Some of you studied the world history with other periodization. Take your hand out. There is no one. And there is not one in the academy of all the world. That is my empirical experience. If is I say to you, that is pure ideology, that is one invention of the Romantic philosophers 200 years ago only, what do you say? Novalis said, the antiquitet, es gibt nicht. The antiquity doesn't exist. We invented said Novalis, the friend of Schlegel and the Schiller, the German romantics. Hegel has a vision of world history. That is my vision before to begin the crisis. Which vision I had of history? I would like to use the black one now. Hegel. That is the expression of the romantic vision of world history and date the interpretation of the world history that we have in all academies almost in the world. The question is not Europe, but too in Africa and Asia and Latin America. They say explicitly in all these lectures on stated on religion and history of philosophy and the philosopher of world history and the philosopher of right. In all books, Hegel is very historical. And he said, the beginning of history is in the East. East. And the history go, doesn't work.
No.
I take my instrument.
You see, a professor must be always.
He said, the history goes from east to west, and Europe is the center and the goal of the world history. It's the centrum und der Zweck der Weltgeschichte. And if you are North American, no American, because I am American too, is perfect because they are the full realization of Europe and they can be Eurocentric. For Hegel, he said explicitly, China is the beginning of the world history, but it's the childhood, it's the child, the beginning, because the freedom began, but only the emperor was free. And the freedom go to the west. After come the India, and after come the Pers Empire, and after come the Hellenistic Empire with Alexander and the Roman Empire. You go from east to west. After come the Middle Age, and after the modernity. And the modernity is the culmination of the world history, but not only. It's the earth of Europe. The earth of Europe is, said Hegel, Germany, Denmark, and England. The south of Europe was Greek, Italy, Spain, Portugal. It's not more in the Enlightenment time. And this central of Europe produced the Industrial Revolution, the Enlightenment and the culture, the reform of the university in Berlin, and from there Sorbonne, from there Oxford, from there Harvard, is the reform of the universities in all the world with division. And if I say it's a pure invention, what is the antiquity? The time before the Middle Age. What is Middle Age? The between antiquity and modernity. I was in India. I gave some lectures in Tamil Nadu and Madurai. And I asked to the students, what you done in the antiquity? He said, what is antiquity? It's this time of the culture of Greek people and Roman people. They say, here was never a Roman and never an Hellenistic people. Tamil Nadu is a country of had 80 million persons at the language, at the history of 4,000 years. has nothing to do with the Hellenistic civilization, the Roman civilization. The antiquity is an invention. The Romantic did explicitly. The Middle Age is a time where Europe was the word is difficult in English, in Spanish is easier. Estuvo como enclaustrado, was separate of the world system by the Ottoman Empire, the expansion of the Muslims from the 62-3 that begin the era of the Muslim world, and Europe was isolate of the old system. We will see what means the Muslim civilization in this time, and what is the end of this age, what is modernity, and in this case, many things that we would like to see in other manner. I have another vision of things, and now it's translated in English. My first book, volume of the Politics of Liberation, published in Edinburgh in English 2 years ago, is a new vision of the world history. I will show you in 15 minutes. But there is 500 pages with bibliography, this different vision of history, to begin and to understand what means this Eurocentric vision of things, because with this vision, I cannot do science. I cannot do science, sociology, philosophy, anthropology, or any, because I always think in the middle from Europe and the other as periphery. I need to have another vision. Very quickly, because you can read, and there is a long bibliography, I don't need to repeat the things, but to see one different vision. The Neolithic Revolution, the cities, the first big civilizations that we know until today. Perhaps the archaeology discovered something different, but it's very difficult. It's in the Mesopotamia. 5,000 before the Common Era, there are cities in Mesopotamia, exactly between the Euphrates and Tigris in the Kuwait region and Iraq. This is the oldest nucleus of civilization in the world, that the barbarian destroyed in the beginning of the 21st century. But that is destroyed. And that is the center of this civilization, because it's 50 kilometers from Babylon. And you can go to the very old cities. And the barbarians of the 21st century destroyed with bombs. That is a criminal act for the future. But because I am Eurocentric, for me, is nothing but that. But us is one city of the Arab people, and the Arab people almost are not human. We can kill 150,000 Iraqis. That is nothing. 25 boys, that is important. We can destroy Libya. Well, that's no problem. But if one person kill 20, that is a terrible world history problem. I spoke with a Jewish professor of Iraq, and I asked, she, you come from Iraq and you are Jewish. From which time your family were there? And she said to me, I am from the Jewish community that produced the Mishnah and the Talmud in the 4th century in Baghdad. But she said to me, now it's destroyed. Good. That is only one anecdote. After we go to Egypt, 2,000, 3,000 before our era began the organization in Egypt, you see difference. We go to India, today Pakistan, 2,000 years ago, the Mohenjo-Daro and the civilization in the Indus River. We go to China, 1,000 years ago began the I Ching, the grand, the big philosophical text in China. And after, we must cross the Pacific and go to America and go to Mesoamerica, the Inca and Maya civilization, but the classical time was from 300 until 700 Teotihuacan. Teotihuacan is a city of 100,000 population. One time I speak with the English professor and say to me, "Are you come from Mexico?" "Oh, the new world." The new world. And I said, "In England, what was the biggest city in the year 300? In England, there were not a city important in the 300. I said, in Mexico, there were a city of 100,000 persons. I am not new, but I am poor. I am not new, because we have to a classical culture. And the Incas too, the Tiahuanaco culture, is more or less the classic time in the same. You see, the history of the urban civilizations go from the west to the east, Mr. Hegel. But you see that I included the American civilization in this moment, not as a context of the discovery of Columbus. Discovery for the Europeans, for the Indians. They didn't discover America. They were with the animals and the vegetals part of the geography of the discovery. 1492 is not the discovery of America, it's the beginning of one invasion. Different question. We must change the vocabulary because the Eurocentrism arrived until this point. And this is too in Latin America, Eurocentric. After I cannot do the old history because it's very complex, the others. Period. That is the first. The second are the big empires of the iron and horses. And in this case, we have the expansion of the so-called Indo-Europeans that arrived with the Chu Chi in China, the Aryans through Kabul in India, the Medos and Persas, the Hellenistic civilization, the Roman civilization, and the Germanic civilization, Indo-Europeans, that organize important empires. I go very quickly. Second period of world history, because I must study China in this moment, India, that is Indo-European, Pers, the Pers, what means? Iran, now. You see, some people would like to do a war against Iran, attention. Iran is a old culture, come from a prestigious traditions, and we must see the history and appreciate the other as this we said. That is the second period. The third period of the world history, like I see, is the expansion of the Semitic civilization. And now it's very important to study the question of the Semites, because from the Egypt, Mesopotamia, where I saw the Africa, India, Indochina, etc. From this region, there is an expansion of people. That is the expansion of the Semitic people. But the Semitic people are the Phoenicians that are the origin of the Greek civilization. The Greek civilization is not so. The miracle of Winterband or the Schlegel or the Romantic. The Romantic invented that the philosophy was born in Greece. That is an invention. Because 3,000 years, there were a philosophy too in Egypt. And there were a philosophy too in Mesopotamia. And the first Greek philosopher we studied in the school of philosophy is Thales of Milet, Mileto, from a Phoenician family. Oh, was Phoenician. Was no Greek, was Phoenician. And we have the books of Martin Bernal, Samerano, and they show how the Greek philosophy comes from Egypt and the Semitic world today in the etymology of words and the concepts and the theorem of Pythagoras. We can see 2,000 before our eras in Assur, Assyria, but not Pythagoras, but Assyrian geometry and mathematics in Egypt. We must discover many new things in this question. The expansion, most important one, the Christian expansion, that is all Europe until the Mesopotamia. But after begin the expansion of the Muslim people, they arrived in the north of Africa until Poitiers, 150 kilometers in Paris, and 736. If the Arab had took Paris, perhaps in this moment I would like to speak in Arab, not in a Latin language. But what stopped there, what stopped in Spain, and the Spain was from 1710 until 1492, January, where the Catholic kings took Granada, that was a Muslim city in Europe, 700 years in the Arab world, with the Caliphate of Cordoba, very important. From Cordoba until Fez, a city with more than 500,000 persons, where is studied the philosophy of Greek philosophers. Why? Because here in Morocco, Tunis, Egypt, El Cairo was the Fatimid. Baghdad was the central city of the old system from the year 8th century until 13th century, Baghdad. And Baghdad was the center of the astronomy. They knew the heliocentric system, the mathematics. We call Arab numbers, our numbers. 1, 2, 3 is Arabs, it's not Europeans. They discover the height mathematics. That's after 600 years after the Europeans begin to discover. In Baghdad, there is the discovery in Aleppo, 860, the discovery of Aristotle, and the empirical science begin to develop it in the Arab world. The philosophy, the Arab philosophy, was the inheritance from the Greek, Byzantine, and Arab civilization. The Latin Germanic civilization was in a crisis, underdeveloped, and Europe, all Europe, was very small in relation with the Arab world. I do a new time the map. Because England, Denmark, Spain, Italy, Greece, the Mediterranean Sea, you say the center of the world, cannot be the center, because you, if you see the world was more a Europe. The Latin Germanic Europe was from Granada until Vienna, and the Arabs put here a wall. And this is the Middle Age. The Middle Age is the isolation of Europe, of the world system, where Baghdad was the center. And the caravans of Baghdad through the Turkestan Chinese arrived to China. China produced all commodities of the world market until this date. The European couldn't sell to China nothing, only could buy with the silver of America product in the Chinese market until good time of the Industrial Revolution that began in China. Read the book of Pomeranz, The Great Divergence. In China began the Industrial Revolution, after in England. The English used all instruments of the China Industrial Revolution. Read the book of Hobson. Hobson is the son of the great son of the author of the Imperialismus that Lenin commanded. He's today professor in Sheffield in England. And he has a book of all instruments of the Industrial Revolution in the agriculture and the factories in England. And he proved that each of the machines was of Chinese inspiration. The Chinese do in 13 an encyclopedia of 60 volumes printing in paper, because they discovered the paper in 6th century. The printing machine in 8th century. In the 9th century, the Chinese printing paper money. And when the Benedict commercial, what was the name of the Italian that was in China?
Marco Polo.
They arrived to China, they couldn't understand how they pay. And they say they pay with paper, with modern paper in 13th century. That to understand that Europe was 6 centuries less developed than China. It's necessary to study the history of technology and history. And the India was in connection. Here we have the central point of the world market until the beginning of 19th century. It's very different, the question. From Baghdad, the caravan was in India, where to Cairo and to Constantinople. Baghdad was the center of the system. And the Arab world was not feudal, was urban, mercantile, not agriculture. The feudalism is a category only European. There is no feudalism in any other place of the world. Feudalism is only here, 70 million persons, and in China, only in China, 150 million, always the double of Europe, because they didn't use horses and cow. And one horse eat 20 times more what like a person. They use the hands to the rice, and they do not need animals and they was always with more demographic expansion, China and India, always from the last 3,000 years, than Europe. And Europe was absolute, isolated, underdeveloped, without science, and the science was in the hand of the Arabs and the Chinese. They knew, the Chinese, the centrality of the sun. He knew the manner of each planet to go around the sun. They knew the year of each planet. They knew the Chinese that was not circular, but ovoid, and the sun was not in the center of the system. Before Copernic, Galileo, and all this, we must begin to study it. The Eurocentrism is very ignorant. Don't know what took from the other civilizations and believe that was pure invention. But the most interesting, I don't speak more because I have no time, is the question of modernity now. What means modernity? And the vision of Turing, that is in America, or Habermas, or of all professors, they say the modernity began in Italy, the Renaissance, is the Lutheran Reformation, the Enlightenment, and the Industrial Revolution in England. It's a geographical temporal movement from Italy to Germany, to France, to England. You say, yes, that is the Industrial Revolution in England, the technological, scientific revolution. So I am Latin America. I say, I am out of history. Latin America is out of history of Hegel and is out of this history. What happened? There is not 16th century in this vision. We go to the 14th century, the 400 in Italy, to the beginning of 16th century with Luther. And that, but in 1492 is the so-called discovery of America. But it's not a question of discovery of America. See you the situation of Europe. The Europe is isolated, and through Italy come to contact with the world market or the Euro-African market and civilization. The Mediterranean Sea was the connection, and the south of Europe, the north of Europe, Norway is the most north of Europe, and England, like Japan here, was the two extremes of the old world of Adam Smith, el old world. That was the old world. And exactly Norwegian, this country, was extreme. You arrived to America, it's true. But why was not connected with the system? Because there were not possibilities. The Atlantic is not the polar on the North Atlantic. The important Atlantic is the tropical Atlantic. That will be the origin of modernity, not the North. Europe do the crusades to take the Holy Land, but was not exactly the Holy Land. Was the possibility of the connection in the Holy Land, the connection with Egypt, Mesopotamia, and China, that's where the possibility of go out of this war of the Ottoman Empire. 1453, the Duke of Constantinople, 1456, begin the translation in Italy of Plato, from Greek to Latin, and to it. Renaissance. What means that? The Greek people that was from Constantinople to Italy because the Ottomans took the city. That means the Renaissance is the presence of the Greek people in Italy. But not only, there is a connection with China. The Book of Menzies show the connections with China because, for example, to Venice arrived maps, and Columbus, that was a Genovese, Italian, he knew the existence of America. And it's very interesting, we have a map of Valde, say, Müller. Valde C. Müller is a priest in Freiburg that do a big map of Asia and put in the south of China the fourth peninsula in the year 1507. More, we have another map, 1487, from Enricus Martellus and Rick Hammer, where there is a big peninsula in the south of China. But strange, this peninsula is exactly with the Golfos and all South America. In the south of China was a confusion. The Europeans took map of China, that's New America. And in the year 1507, Valde C. Müller has a map with the peninsula in the south of China and do a design of America without the Istmo of Panama, with the coast, the Atlantic and Pacific of America, with the Rocky Mountains and the Andes. In this year, where Magellan's didn't arrive until this moment to the Magellan's, because Magellan's discovered the Strictus Magellan in 1518. And this map card was before the discovery of Magellan's. And there is the Falkland Islands and the South Pole, before Columbus. Fantastic. That means Europe couldn't go to the connection with the system in the East. The only place for Europe to go out of this world of the Arab world was the Atlantic. The Atlantic. The tropical Atlantic. And that was Columbus. Columbus from Seville arrived, you know where? Here. And the Journal of Columbus, he said, we are right in Asia. We are very close to the Grand Khan. The Europeans know that in all these regions there were Khans, Mongols. They project the Khans until China. And Columbus said, I arrived to a country not so far from the Khans. And he was here, but he believed that was here. In the fourth trip of Columbus, 1503, he died in 1506, he arrived to Panama, that's here. And he wrote in the journal, we are in the distance of 10 days of navigation of the Ganges. The Ganges is here. And he believed that was here, in 10 days he could arrive to the Ganges and was in Panama. That means that Columbus was only in Asia. Psychologically and existentially, he never discovered America. Americo Vespucci knew the big, he was here and knew the peninsula in south of China, was in the south and was very big, more big than he thought. And he said, it's a new continent, but not America, but a big peninsula in south of China, but a big continent. You understand that means the Europeans can go out of the city, this position, only in the Atlantic. Spain discovered, to call, Asia first, because of that they put the name Indians, of Nehru, to the Indians of America. And the beginning they were in Asia, but very quickly they discovered that that's not Asia, and that is a problem. What is? That is the beginning of modernity. Not Mr. Habermas, Mr. Toulmin, Mr. Burkhardt, in all the Europeans. America, the modernity, is the openness of Europe. First, through the Atlantic to America, through Portugal in Africa, and through Africa until Ceylon, until Japan, and discovered through the oceans, the world. And now they put the Arabs in the center and they invented the situation, because the Arabs before put here a wall, but now they put a wall to the Arabs, and was the crisis of the only universal civilization from Morocco and Spain until Philippines. The Arabs were present in Morocco, Tunis, Cairo, Fatimi, Mesopotamia, Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, the Mughal in India, the Kingdom of Malacca, until the Philippines. The Arabs were from the Pacific to the Atlantic, and Europe was only the small Europe in the Middle Age. You understand? Other vision of things. I hope. Now we can begin to speak. Now we can begin. And understand that when China now growing, it's not a miracle. It was always more developed than Europe. Only two last centuries is a siesta tropical. But now, said what happened, very quickly can be developed. The Arabs, and any problem with the science, they invented the modern science. The Enlightenment difference between faith and reason, that is Averroes in Cordoba. They take the faith of the Quran and the philosophy of Aristotle and said it's different. That is Enlightenment. That is Arab Muslim, not European. They have no problems. They were more advanced than Europe. The moment Europe studied, took, and developed 2 centuries and become hegemonical. The American now are more hegemonical, and now it's finished. It's not more the hegemony of Europe, and the America come back, the Asia and Latin America begin a new way. Why? Because the 16th century...
We have just arrived to Latin America, to America now, but maybe we can have a break, for a break, 5 minutes.
Or perhaps I shorter to see the...
Okay.
I speak 10 minutes, okay. Finish. The modernity is the question. Is the openness to Europe, to the Atlantic,
And so did you see, for example, for the philosopher? There is a philosopher here. No, one. Good. I'm well interested if there were one. But the philosophers are the Eurocentric per excellence. See, perhaps they subsume the subject and we are not here. The philosophers think that the modern philosophy begins with Descartes. Descartes wrote the method, the discourse on method in Amsterdam in 1637. It's not indifferent the date and the place. Amsterdam, Descartes, 1637. The Leviathan of Hobbes, 42. In these dates begin to Newton. That means is the moment where the traditional vision of modernity said there in the beginning of 17th century begin the modernity, the philosophy, and the scientific revolution and technology. I say no, that begin in the beginning of 16th century. And that is the important hypothesis. Philosophically, the question was this. They arrived to America, absolute and null. And the first question is, these people are human beings. Are human beings? And that is a philosophical question. But they say, yes, they are human beings. But the cultures converted these people in beasts, in animals. That means an absolute negative vision on the culture of the other. And it's the tabula rasa. And the second question, in ethics and political science and in law, I can justify the conquest and the domination of these people. And Ginés de Sepúlveda reread Aristotle and said, yes, they are like slaves. If we dominate these people, we give the civilization and the Christianity and justify the expansion of Europe until Bush. Or until OTAN in Libya. In Libya. That means Europe justified the possibility of dominate other civilization and people with the foundational moment of humanize these people to give the civilization. Hegel said England become the missionary de civilization in the world, the missionary of the civilization in the world. So in the name of the European civilization, that is the same as be human, and not to be European is not to be human. That is new, it's not new. It's very Greek, it's very ethnocentric. Parmenides, philosopher in Greek, this, the being is the non-being, is not. You say, it's naive, it's obvious. No. The Greek is the being, the non-Greek is not human. Aristotle said, the human being is a political animal. No, they didn't say that. They see the anthropos, and thropos. I am too forgetful. The anthropos is a living being that is in a Hellenic city, politikos. And the people that is not in an Hellenic city is not human. The Europeans in the north of Greece, that was Macedonia, are not human. The barbarians are not human. The Asiatic, they are intelligent, but not force. Are not human, the Egyptians. Only were human, the Greek. The being is, the non-European is not. That is the philosophy of the God. But I have no time. That means it's necessary to rethink all. Because the Eurocentrism is the ontological horizon of all human science, the economy, anthropology, communication science, philosophy, all human science. And if you don't destroy this Eurocentric vision, you cannot read the newspapers. Because I don't understand what means China, India. And today, we are in the train, and we see now the news. Cristina Fernandez in Argentina is like a Gaddafi, because now we like nationalize the oil of Repsol, that is a company of Spain, on the Union. European Union is with Spain against Argentina and begin the propaganda. But nobody asked, this oil is Argentine. And the Repsol is a foreigner company and nothing to do. And didn't accomplish the contract. But you see, the propaganda is Eurocentrical. And that is the same with Hussein. We did a war in Iraq because they had massive instrument of destruction, bomb atomics, atomics bomb. We are not, but we destroyed Iraq. And now we suppose that Iran has bombs, and we do that. Why? Because this Eurocentric vision from the 16th century, not from the 17th century, begin to found all actions. In Latin America, we need to make a reconstruction of this ideology. And we call, and I finish, the decolonization term. Term is hero. It's a changement in the epistemological level to be colonial or to be autonomous. To be colonial is thinking with this Eurocentric vision of things that didn't allow to see the reality. We need a total transformation in the epistemological level of all social science. Without that, we cannot see the reality. The reality is, if you go to China or India or an Arab world or Bantu Africa or Latin America, they are other history. They are human like I. They suffer the colonialism that was a product of the modernity. They suffer the capitalism that is a product of modernity. And all these questions explain the situation where they are now. But that means a more critical thinking, for example, of the Frankfurt School, Adorno, Horkheimer, Marcuse, Appel, Habermas, etc., are critical, beautiful, interesting, but Eurocentric. All them, I spoke with them, and personally, you are Eurocentric. And I say, I am not. Why? I suffered the Eurocentrism. And I began this small talk to say, I was Eurocentric. And I remain always. In old days, I begin to go out of some aspect of my Eurocentrism that I studied in my high school, in my university in a peripheral country too. That is sad, but it's real. It's too much time.